title companies, real estate brokers. I want to talk about how to sell the property when the owner has died without wasting your time and ending up with nothing. I'm attorney Vernita Williams. We all know that experience. We worked very hard only to find out the deal falls through. Well, this is a 7-part series in which I will discuss a number of things. This is part 4 of the series. And in part 4, I'm going to talk about managing the heirs who now own the property. You know, there's a management element to dealing with the heirs sometimes. They're not always agreeable, so you have to manage them sometimes. Before this part 4, I talked in part 1 about what you will learn from the series, and part 2 about 2 ways to sell a property of a deceased owner. In part 3, I shared 7 steps to selling that property through probate court. And this is part 4. Now I'm going to talk about managing those heirs. 2 things. You must manage the heirs' expectations. That's number 1. And number 2, sometimes you have to manage difficulties that the heirs create. Now, first about their expectations. Guess what? If they're selling through probate court, they are not always going to be able to get money at closing. That's extremely important because as a realtor, a title company, a real estate broker, you don't want a whole bunch of people angry with you because they thought they were going to get money at closing. So they must understand they're not going to always get money at closing. Usually in a probate sale, the court is going to receive that money in a restricted depository and disperse the funds later. The other thing is this. Sometimes the heirs may have judgments and liens against them, and if they do, those judgments and liens might have to be paid out of the sales proceeds. So in that title commitment, pay very, very close attention to if any of those heirs have judgments and liens against them, because there needs to be some kind of discussion before closing, so when they find out, yeah, I had a credit card judgment for not paying a credit card bill 10 years ago, not 10 years ago, but maybe 5 years ago, and instead of it being $2,000, it's now $5,000, and it came out of my money, that needs to be a discussion before the closing. So those 2 things under managing client expectations. The other thing is, what about the difficult heirs? You know, sometimes you'll have 1 out of 5 who won't sign the paperwork, who won't correspond, they won't answer you. So when you have that going on and you need that 1 person out of 5 to sign closing documents, you may need to have the court appoint a special master. I've had several cases where I had to get around that difficult heir. You might also, if you have a lot of confusion about whether the property should be sold or whether an heir can ignore the whole process and shut the whole thing down, sometimes people are behaving that way simply because they have been ignored by the heir that's trying to sell the property. So I have found in many instances a family meeting where all local family members come to my office. If they are out of town, I will have a conference call-in number where they can call in. Sometimes a family meeting where you explain the probate process, that nobody is getting ripped off, that the court is protecting everyone's interests. Sometimes that's all that is necessary to get the family together. So this is part 4. We're talking about managing the client's expectations and also dealing with those difficult heirs. We gave a few suggestions. If you would like more information on how to sell the property of a deceased owner without wasting your time and ending up with nothing, please visit my website, that is vcwlaw.com, vcwlaw.com, or you can call me at 786-831-9483. There will also be part 5 on attorney's fees and realtor fees, part 6 on timelines, just how long will this process take in probate court, and part 7, which will summarize all of the key points that I have made in this 7-point series.